My name is Jez Daly, and on behalf of Clifden Arts Festival, I would like to welcome you all to this very special event. We are deeply honoured to have Tomi Reichental to speak with us, and I am joined by three students from Clifden Community School, Maeve O'Neill, Sarah Conlon, and Grace Thornton, and their history teacher, Mary Ellen Cronin. I would like to thank Clifden Community School and Nicola Snow for arranging this talk. And we are also grateful to the Community Foundation of Ireland and the Siachán Foundation for supporting this event. In Tomi Reichental's book, I Was a Boy in Belsen, he states, "I realized that as one of the last witnesses, I must speak out." And for many years, Tomi has done just that. Travelling in Ireland and abroad and speaking with young people in schools, as he is doing here today, where he has been a living testament to the truth of the Holocaust for a new generation. It is a difficult and often heart-wrenching task to share many horrific memories from a period of history that seems almost unimaginable through its cruelty and huge loss of life. But it needs to be remembered, and it is a great privilege and honour to introduce a living witness to the horrors of the Second World War, from whom we, as a younger generation, and learn so much. So students and ladies and gentlemen, it gives me a great privilege to introduce Tomi Reichental, and you're welcome to Clifden, Tomi.
Well, thank you for the introduction. That takes a lot of it out of my problem to introduce myself. It is great honor to do this Zoom. I'm doing this type of thing quite a lot now because, of course, of the COVID-19. And the message goes through as well this way. I thought during the COVID now I'm completely out of touch with the student, but it's not true. I have also other booking now to do it. And for me, of course, to give the message, it's very important. And today it is more important even that years ago, because of course the anti-Semitism and racism, which is on the rise, and we reading and listening about the event that it's are happening around the world, just lately in Sweden in the last couple of days in the northern state, Norway as well. We had outburst against other minority, which reminds me, of course, what happened to me in the 40s. And that's why it is important that I speak and remind the student, the young generation, how careful we have to be that such thing don't happen again. And that's what history is important for, because if we don't learn from the history, it bound to happen again. And this is why I'm always ready, and anybody that asks me, I'm delighted to speak in order that we don't forget, and that it reminds us that if we're not careful and we don't adhere to a democratic order, things can get out of hand. And it is the education that I'm very keen to be involved with, because only with the education we teach the young generation how careful we must be. And so I like, sort of in a short session, to remind you and anybody else, of course, that will have the opportunity to see this Zoom, how important it is that we learn about the past and avoid any bullying also in our schools, where I'm always reminded of that we have also racism in Ireland and bullying, racial bullying. And I hope my contribution will help in this respect. So I speak about the Holocaust, how it happened, and how quickly it can happen. And by the time people realized what was happening, it was too late. And that's why education is so important, that we don't find ourselves in a similar situation. I would like to start with the idea that when we remember the Holocaust, we usually speak about the numbers, what happened, how many Jews perished. And if I ask sometime a student, what you know about the Holocaust, basically they would say to me, well, 6 million Jews were murdered in this time, which is of course true, but it's not only the number. We have to know what happened. And I have here a quote from another Holocaust survivor, which I like to read, because it's exactly what I used to try to say, but I never found the right word. And it was Thomas Bergin-Belsen, or as I said, also a Holocaust survivor. And what he said, to speak about the Holocaust in terms of numbers, 6 million, which is the way it's usually done, is unintentionally to dehumanize the victims and to trivialize the profound human tragedy it was. And that's exactly what I tried to convey, but I never found a proper word. So what is Holocaust? Holocaust is not only about the number. Holocaust was about racism, loss of freedom, loss of dignity, humiliation, loss of education, confiscation of property, enslavement, starvation, torture, mass execution, and finally the extermination, which we called a final solution. It was decided at the Wannsee Conference on the 20th of January 1942. It's not far from Berlin. I actually visited the villa where the decision was made. There were about 13 high-ranking officials Among them was Reinhard Heydrich and Adolf Eichmann. And Reinhard was the one that initiated the whole meeting. And at this meeting, the decision was made to annihilate the entire Jewish population of Europe. Of course, tragically, they succeeded to kill 6 million. But because I'm a survivor, I usually speak about the survival. So in short, I like to just mention that I was born in Slovakia. I lived in a small village, Merasice. It was a farming community. My father was a farmer, and we lived in Slovakia for the generation. When I was building the family tree, I was able to get back to 1700, and already we were in living in Slovakia. My father served in the Slovak army. I had other relatives that had an important part in the Slovak society. One of them was one of the first pilots in the Slovak Air Force. So we consider ourselves Slovak citizens. And we lived, I remember my childhood, I considered the village paradise for me. I had a beautiful life, but all this ended in 1939 when Sudetenland was taken over by the Germans, and also they imposed the puppet government in Slovakia. The leader was a Roman Catholic priest. His name was Joseph Tiso. He surrounded himself with anti-Semite. He was anti-Semite. He didn't like Jews. And he surrounded himself with nationalists and became a dictator in Slovakia and with the support of Germany. But in fact, Slovakia was not occupied by Germany, while rest of Europe was being occupied simply because Slovakia was one of the first nations that cooperated with the Nazi regime in Germany. Slovakia helped during the beginning of the war because it started on the Polish borders, and of course Slovakia borders Poland. So through Slovakia they used to transport equipment, manpower from Germany to the Polish border and help with the war effort. So for this reason, Germany really did not have any reason to occupy Slovakia. And not only that, but Germany used the situation that they didn't occupy Slovakia for the propaganda, telling the other nation if they cooperate with Germany, they have no interest to occupy the country. So the relation between Slovakia and Germany was very close. And of course, with that, also the propaganda and the hatred and the persecution of Jews. And because at the time, the system of spreading the propaganda was not very developed, like we have it today. We have the radios, the newspaper, the politician, we have television. So anything the government wants to convey to the population. They have many options, but at the time it was very difficult, and therefore the propaganda was spread through the church. Slovakia was also very Roman Catholic country, like Ireland is still today, and people were good citizens, and they followed the religion, and unfortunately through the churches they preach that all the trouble that Slovakia is experiencing is the fault of the Jews. If something didn't work right, they blame the Jews for it. And so is this propaganda instilled into the population for a long time. Slowly the people began to believe, and that's why we began to feel the hatred around us. But it wasn't only that we were persecuted and cut off the society, but we ourselves, for example, in the village, we had a lot of friends, and slowly we began to avoid them, not because we wanted to avoid them, but because we didn't want to get them into trouble if they familiarized themselves with us. People will begin to talk about them as sympathizer to the Jews, and they would create for them difficulties. So all this started in 1939. The Slovak government then brought out even laws against the Jews, one of the most drastic laws that was called the Jewish Codex, was terrible for us. It had 270 paragraphs exempting us from all kind of activities, and we were not allowed to go to national school. We had to wear a yellow star. Jewish property was being taken away, and all our kind of action against the Jewish people. And therefore I was thrown out. I started the school in the village. I was thrown out, and I had to go to the neighboring town where there were there was a large Jewish community, and therefore there were several Jewish schools. And it was the first time that at this time, when I went to the school, to the Jewish school in the town, that I had to wear a yellow star, because in the village I didn't wear it. We didn't have the police in the village, so nobody could enforce the law. But when I was in the town, I had to wear it, and when I went on the street, the children shouted at me, "You dirty Jew, you smelly Jew." And as the time went on, they were more aggressive, and they were throwing stone after me. They would try to catch me, to beat me up, which they did once or twice. I used to come to my aunt and tell her I don't want to go to school, but it wasn't an option. But not long afterwards, persecution went on, and the deportation of Jews began in Slovakia. It began in March 1942, and our teachers were taken away, so the Jewish school closed, and I was sent home. So my education stopped I only remember after the war, where I started to go to school again. It was very embarrassing for me because I was already 10 years old and I couldn't read, I couldn't write, I couldn't do mathematics. And I had to go to these children of 6-7 years old to school. So you can imagine the children could not understand why I can't read. They just thought I'm stupid. They would bully me for it. So I had a tough time to get going while there, where after the day in the school, they went home and play football and game outside. I was sitting home and I had to learn because I wanted to catch up with my own age. I didn't want to sit with 7 year old. At that age, a year makes a huge difference. So all my childhood really was lost through the time that I was in the concentration camp. And then, of course, when I come out with the learning, I must say that eventually I managed to go to college. I managed to qualify as a diploma engineer, and I didn't do badly in my adult life. But it was tough time while other children were able to enjoy themselves. I had to sit home and learn. So once the deportation started, it started in March 1942. Most of the Jewish population from Slovakia was taken away. Slovakia before the war had about 85,000-90,000 Jews. Once the deportation started, it continued from March till October. And during this time, out of 85,000, 58,000 Jews were deported. And according to the statistic after the war, from these 58,000 Jews that were deported, only between 280 and 500 survived. Rest of them were all murdered in Auschwitz and Lublin, in the extermination camp in Poland. Among them were over 30 relatives, my aunt, uncle, cousin, whom I knew very well. They used to come for holiday into the village and we used to play with them, my cousin. I remember them very well. And it is only in the late years, I of course, did not speak about my experiences for over 60 years, not because I didn't want to speak about it, but I just couldn't speak about it. But it was in the last 10, 15 years that we remembering our cousin and aunt, and when we meet as the family with my brother, cousin, that we survived, we speak about these people like they were still among us. We remember them so well. They were very intelligent people, accountant, engineer, architect. They just, one day were taken away. We said goodbye and we never saw them again. But unfortunately, we managed to hide until 1944, when Slovakia had an uprising. And during this time, the Slovak people rebelled against the Tiso regime, which was a fascist regime. And it was then, for the first time in September, that the German occupied Slovakia, and not because they wanted to occupy Slovakia, but because they wanted to save the Tiso regime that was sympathetic to the Nazi regime. And it was at this time that we were betrayed. And in October 1944, we were caught by the Gestapo, which was the German secret police, and the Hlinka Guard, which was the Slovak police, and we were deported to Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. We arrived in the camp on the 2nd of November, 1944. When we arrived there, what we saw, the only way I can describe it was hell on earth. We saw skeletons walking around. They were starved. They were just skin and bone. They walked very slowly. They were totally emaciated and weak. They sometimes they just fell to the ground, never to get up again. It transpired, and we found out about it only after several days that we were there, that we were in the women camp where the hospital was. And the hospital, what we saw were the patients from the hospital. Of course, unfortunately, the hospital wasn't there to cure people, but they brought the woman, the sick woman, and they had to be very sick to the hospital, not to be cured, but basically just to die there. And this is what we saw front of our eye every day. We saw a lot of cruelty, people being beaten up, and for anything minor, just as a way of punishment. If you did anything out of the usual, out of the norm that you were allowed to do, you were punished. And we used to see it in the other blocks around. The day would start with a roll call, which in itself was a very cruel event, because it was winter, November, December, January. Every morning we had to go to a stand for a roll call, which would last an hour or more, standing in a freezing cold. In northern Germany at the time, the temperature used to drop to minus 15, 20 degrees. And, you know, we know here we had several years ago, I remember the temperature dropped to minus 10 degrees, which was just awful, because even though we have our double glazing and we have our central heating, it was so unusual. It was very, very cold. So you can imagine, we lived in this type of temperature and even lower, 15 degrees minus, in just flimsy wooden huts without double glazing, no heatings, with very little clothing. And for night, we only had two blankets. So we used to live in our clothes basically 24 hours. It was a horrific experience. Not only that, we went to starvation. When we arrived to the camp, suddenly the food was not very nourishable, and it also wasn't very much. But we got for eating, we had three meals a day. It started in the morning after the roll call. We would have black coffee and two slices of bread. For lunch, we would have turnips, which were cut into little square and boiled in water. And in the evening, we had again two slices of bread and black coffee, basically black water. So that's that coffee really was the liquid that we had for the day, because the water from the tap was contaminated. It wasn't clean enough. And if you drank the water from the tap, you got diarrhea, you got dehydrated, and it would kill you. And also, you got all kind of illnesses like typhus, diphtheria, tuberculosis. So the life was very, very harsh. And when you begin to be fed with such a small amount of food, you begin to be hungry, and eventually you starve. And we didn't starve for a day or week. We starved for months. You get your food and you eat it and you're still hungry, and you get the next meal and you're still hungry. So constantly, all the time, what you do, you're thinking about the next meal, when it will come. And eventually, of course, the body begin to eat itself from inside. You become like a skeleton, and finally you die. It is only a matter of time, but you can survive. So people were dying in Bergen-Belsen all the time. Bergen-Belsen was not an extermination camp. Bergen-Belsen was a detention camp, but people were dying all the time. And it is estimated that during the existence of Bergen-Belsen, around 70,000 people died. It is about 20,000 prisoners of war. There were Polish and Russian prisoners of war, and over 50,000 Jewish detainees, and also Gypsies and Jehovah Witnesses, and also gay and lesbian were imprisoned in Bergen-Belsen. Also political prisoners, German prisoners, who were not treated any better than the Jewish prisoners. So the life was very unpleasant. It was in the beginning of 1945 that the German army began to retreat from the west to the east, from Poland back to towards Germany and Czechoslovakia. And as they were retreating, they were taking their prisoners with. So many come to Bergen-Belsen. It is estimated that over 35,000 prisoners from other camps come to Bergen-Belsen within very short periods. There was no room for them. There was no food for them. So the camp began to become overpopulated, and the food became even smaller than we used to get. Instead of three meals, we only got two meals a day. And people began to die in vast number. In Bergen-Belsen, as I said, Bergen-Belsen was not an extermination camp. We didn't have gas chamber in Bergen-Belsen, but we had crematorias in Bergen-Belsen for the purpose to burn the corpses of the people that were dying in the camp. One of the purposes was that the German thought from the beginning they will be victorious, and they didn't want to leave any mark of the tragedy that happened to in Bergen-Belsen. And therefore, when they burned the corpses, we did not have any graves or graveyard for people, because their ashes were just thrown away. And that's what the German thought, that after the war, they could say, well, nobody died in Bergen-Belsen, everything was okay there. So when so many people began to die in January, February, March in Bergen-Belsen, the crematoria no longer could cope, because people were dying in vast number, 500 per day, 15,000 per month. So they just threw the corpses outside, and small piles of corpses were lying all around the place. As children, we used to play among these corpses. The situation there was just unbelievable. It's difficult to describe. The corpses were decomposing and rotting away. The stench was unbelievable. We were starving. And it was only a matter of time that we wouldn't have survived either. I remember myself, I was in a very bad shape. I was like a skeleton. And at the time, we thought if we will not be liberated soon, then who knows? And we knew at the time what was happening. We knew that the German army was retreating, because the prisoners, they come from Auschwitz and other camp, they told us that they are retreating and it's only a matter of time that we will be liberated as well. And so it was 15th of April, 1945. I will never forget that day when we heard this rumbling entering Bergen-Belsen camp, and we all ran towards the barbed wire to see what was happening, and we could see tanks and lorries with soldiers shouting through loud "This is the British Army. You are being liberated." And on that day, the table turned around. We became free, and the guards, they became the prisoners of the Allied forces. So that's how we were liberated. It just came. We never knew until a couple of days, about 4 days before, that something is happening, because it was on the 11th of April that the watchtower were empty. There were no guards in it, but still people were afraid to leave the camp. They didn't know if there is the Germans are outside waiting, if they get out and they will start to shoot us. So people just stayed in, and after 4 days, suddenly it was afternoon that we were liberated by the British Army. So that's about the story of my survival. It's a miracle that we survived. And as I said, if we were not liberated on the day we were, I don't know how much longer I would have survived. So I just would like to finish with a poem which is very appropriate for this story or lecture or whatever we want to call it. It was written by Yehuda Bauer in 2001. And the poem goes, I just want to remind, especially the students, that if they see or hear somebody in the school that they have some bullying going on, as I mentioned before, we must remember that Holocaust did not start with gas chamber. It started with whisper, with taunt, with dubbing, and finally murder. I'm not suggesting that it can happen here, but if anybody hears such a thing or sees such a thing, not become a bystander, but to get involved and say it's wrong, because sometimes these things start from a very small group, and it's sort of macho to be one of the things. Get involved, say it's wrong. And because today Ireland is a multinational society. When I arrived to Ireland, which is 60 years ago, there were hardly any foreign people, but today I think about 17% we have foreigners here. So unfortunately we have racism as well. Coming back, I'd like to recite this little poem. The horror of Holocaust is not that it deviated from the human norms. The horror is that it didn't. What happened might happen again to others, not necessarily Jews, perpetrated by others, not necessarily Germans. We are all possible victims, possible perpetrators, possible bystanders. Thank you for having the patience. And if you have any question, I would be delighted to answer.
Why did you choose to come to Ireland after your experience in the Holocaust?
Ireland story, this is a question, of course, I get asked many times. How I come to Ireland? It's a long story. I did not come as a refugee to Ireland. It was in the 60s, late 59, the beginning of 60s. I was coming here to set up a factory in Ireland. It was a British industrialist that wanted to set up a factory in Ireland to manufacture zip. And he basically discovered that I was studying in Germany, because at the time, in 1957, I went late 56, I went to Germany to study engineering. And I just finished, I qualified as an engineer when this industrialist heard about me, and he basically offered me this job to come to Ireland and set up the factory for him. And that's how I came to Ireland in late 59. And while I was here setting the factory up, I met a Jewish girl here, and I fell in love with the girl and got married. And that's why I'm still today. So unfortunately, my wife passed away in 2003. She had cancer, but I met in 2005, I met another Jewish lady, and she's my partner, Joyce. And so I'm very lucky I'm not alone. But that's my story, how I come to Ireland. And it's my home today. I'm Irish. It's my home, and I love the people. I love the country.
Did you ever try to escape from the camp?
No. Well, just to you know, people try to escape, but it would be wrong to say that they try to escape from the camp, because it wasn't possible to escape. What they tried to escape from was from the suffering that they were going through. Because in Bergen-Belsen, people were dying due to disease and starvation and cold. And it was a very long process. And it was a very painful process. In other words, when you got typhoid, you didn't die after a couple of days. It took weeks and months. If you were starving, it took weeks and sometimes months. And it was very, very painful. And some people were in our camp, the women, they just couldn't bear the pain. So in the night, they would just run towards the perimeter. They would begin to climb the perimeter. And the guard, of course, would discover them, and they would shoot them. And we used to hear these shots being fired. And in the morning, only in our section, because every 300 meter was a watchtower. So in our section, every morning, we would find two or three corpses hanging on the barbed wire. You know, these were women that were trying to escape. But as I say, they didn't try to escape the camp. They tried to escape the suffering. Basically, they committed suicide. And this was happening all around the camp. And it was happening every night. So it was a horrific sight every morning when we saw some corpses lying over the wires.
What did you do when you were first liberated?
We were not allowed to leave the camp for a very long time. I was sent to hospital. I was in very bad shape. I was like a skeleton. So after the liberation, I was sent to the hospital in Bergen-Belsen. I went with my aunt as well. My aunt got typhus, just at the end, before we were liberated. So I went with my aunt, and I actually saved my aunt to survive, because we were brought to this hospital. We got very little to eat because, unfortunately, many prisoners, they were starving for a long time. And when the British Army liberated the camp, they left several trailers out full with food. And the food was the army standard food. And the army standard food was very strong in protein and meat, beef in tins. And of course, when they saw this food, the prisoner began to eat it, and the stomach was not able to digest it because it was for the soldier to make them stronger, to be able to fight. And the prisoners, they were like skeleton. the stomach was not able to digest it, and many of them died. It is estimated that before the British Army realized what was happening, they estimate that about 2,000 prisoners died after the liberation due to this blunder of leaving this very heavy food for the prisoner. And so when we went to the hospital, we got very little food. They started to feed us very, very slowly, so that we don't more or less choke from the food. And I remember as a kid, I was at the time nearly 10 years old, and there was nothing wrong with me physically, only that I was very, very weak and like a skeleton, and I was starving. And I went to the nurses, and I was one of the only children in that hospital, and they all spoiled me. I was running around, and I used to ask them for food, and they said, you know, that we can't give you our food, because of course it was not kosher. You know, it was pork and not food that they said, it's not kosher, I can't give it. I said, forget about the kosher, I'm hungry, give me. And then they gave me some sandwiches with pork, which I'm not supposed to eat. I was so hungry. But my aunt, she was very sick, and she wouldn't eat. And that's what was the tragedy, that many inmates that come to the hospital and they were given food. There were not enough nurses. There were thousands and thousands of sick people, I think, in the room that I was. There were about six patients in. And they would bring the food, and they would leave the food to each patient, and they were told they have to eat. But nobody came. There were not enough nurses. And I was trying to make my aunt to eat, and she just was saying, I'm not hungry, I want cigarette, I want cigarette. And I would go to the nurses and beg them for cigarette, and they would look at me and say, you say cigarette, you are only a kid, you can't. I said, it's not for me, it's for my aunt. And then I would come to my aunt, and I would sort of break the cigarette in half, and I would count her sort of in my hand. I said, here, I have a cigarette. I gave you the cigarette, but you have to first eat the food that is on the table there. And she was so desperate to get the cigarette that she would eat. So I would give her half a cigarette, and it was like thing. And then, of course, I had the other half in my hand. And he said, give me the other half. I said, well, there is a glass of water. If you drink the water, I give you the other half. And so I made my aunt eating and drinking, and she survived. Many of the patients in the room, I remember, were just taken out. They all were dying. Nobody was looking after them. And I remember many years afterwards, every time I went to visit my aunt, and if there was somebody visiting her, she would say, you see that man? He saved my life. So I really did save the life of my aunt.
Tomi, I'm so grateful to you for speaking to us here today. At the end of your book, Tomi, you say when you revisited Belsen, Bergin-Belsen, in 2007, that you said there were no birds. Was that?
Yeah, Yeah, I visited Bergen-Belsen several times since then. First, it was the reason was that I made three documentary films, and we used to go every time with the film crew to Bergen-Belsen to film there. And it was an interesting feeling. We always sort of felt that we could never see any birds flying. It was very, very calm, very no animals around at all. And the people that were taking visitors around, showing the camp, because of course many people are coming today to visit Bergen-Belsen, and especially student. There is a project in Germany. Every student have to visit the concentration camp. And I asked him, I said, I mean, it's a beautiful place when you're looking at it. Today, I remember for the first time when I come to visit the camp, which was only about what it would have been, about 7-10 years ago, even a little more, 12 years ago. I remember we went off the buses, and then we went sort of up a hill towards the camp, and here in front of us this area open with beautiful green grass, and we remember it where all these corpses were lying at the time we were in the camp. Now it's beautiful forest, and you just can't imagine scout groups coming to play there and having a good time. But at the time when we were there, of course, it was a horrible place. And so when I asked the people there, how come that in such a beautiful forest you don't see any birds or animal running around, she said, it's not true. There is plenty of life in the forest. There are foxes, rabbits, and birds flying around. It just did you notice, sort of, it was very quiet. I don't know why.
Tomi, I think we're all so thankful to you for your talk here today. I know that Clifden Arts Festival and the community school wish to thank you. And as we have said before, we cannot wait to have you down to speak to a larger group of students here in the school, which we will do. But I know your message to Grace and to Maeve and to Sarah is so important in regard to bullying and racism in present day. And I know that bring your message to all the other students as they go along. And really, Tomi, we wish to thank you again on behalf of the Clifden Arts Festival and all of us here for carrying on speaking and remembering and telling new generations what needs to be said and needs to be remembered. Thank you very much, Tomi.
Thank you very much also having me. Thank you.